So thanks, Alex, for an excellent day's program. It's a shame if you missed some of it because it was cool. We had a lot of people saying smart things about Fiesta. Now I'm going to try and say something kind of clever. See how it goes. I was asked to talk today because I talked another time, and Alex liked how I compared Neolithic cave walls to modern plastered ones. Since then, I've started discovering my master thesis, which is about social hope and the power of utopias. Today, I'm going to dissect and analyse past examples of Fiesta and use them to formulate how I imagine future possible Fiestas could be used in combination with utopic thinking in the struggle to formulate a better future for everyone on planet Earth, with a focus on active, ritualistic, future-orientated actions. First, I have two questions. Question one, is there anyone here who is willing and capable of playing the guitar in a kind of strummy, flamenco-y, ritual-y kind of way? No one capable of playing the guitar. Julia, you don't play the guitar. Alex, play the guitar. Okay, good to know. It's fine. We'll deal with that bridge when we come to it. And question number two is about the future of planet Earth. I'd just like a show of hands, if that's possible. Please put your hands up if you are positive about the future of planet Earth. One. Good. Two. Great. Please put your hands up if you're negative about the future of planet Earth. One, two, three, four, five, six. No answer. Okay, six, good. Plus me, that makes seven. That's really good for my research. Right then, let's go. Fiesta! So, Alex told me a fiesta has to have four things in it to be a fiesta. Music. Food. Alcohol. And theatre. Which for me is maybe the murkiest area, which I think I'm trying to understand through this talk. As we've established, I'm worried about the future. A truck stop. Imagine flat, even tarmac stretching away into the dim room. Nothing grows here. The big powerful machines, lying dormant upon it in endless rows, are ready and waiting to pour more goods from here to there, joining the crisscrossing strings that thread around our globe in endless lines. The truck stop. And it wasn't just any old truck stop either. It was the one down by the room, near to the room, across from the room. You know the one I mean? Mm-hmm. The one in the lightning storm. Well, anyway, that's where I found the boat. And here I am, floating theatrically. I'm not sure if it's the right theatre for a fiesta. We'll get to that. On the sea, at the end of the world. Bobbing up and down with the last of my shopping. And my guitar. So talking of my guitar, I think it might be time for a little music to go with the theatre. Would you like to hear a song that I was going to sing at the end of the world?
Yeah.
Alright. Phew, we got through the talky thing. Alright, good. It goes like this.
Hey, it's okay to move in that way. The machines saying primeval inmates.
They did it by attaching themselves to these organisms and kind of piggybacking them to make use of the extra energy generated from the oxygen. This piggybacking continued all the way up through the animal kingdom until it reached us, the pinnacle of evolution, right? That's why our bodies function at around 37 degrees Celsius and our insides are salty. That's the temperature and spiciness of the primordial oceans. So we carry those first organisms around inside of us, piggybacking their original function inside our own personal primordial seas, helping us to continue on our way to. So here I am, out at sea with my guitar in a boat made of a fridge. watching the waters rise and waiting to return to the warm, salty waters. The last of the three shopping stored in the bottom for provisions. Though, you know, I'm not really out at sea, am I? In fact, I never did actually get to sing that song in my fridge, floating on the sea at the end of the world. Because not only did the world not end yet, but the boat that I found at the truck stop, as I just said, in the lightning storm, was actually not only a boat, it's probably, it won't cause a great surprise to you, I'm not sure. It was actually a Samsung family fridge. So I was out there at the truck stop near the wire fence between the trucks at the back of the truck stop where lightning strikes in the first of those movies. What's it called? The lightning storm and the trucks? Terminator? With Arnold Schwarzenegger? So that's why I was visiting the truck shop. I thought it would be a good place to find a depressing object of some sort to use as a boat. And I was secretly kind of hoping that I would run into the Terminator and he would just finish me off then and there, so I didn't have to worry about it anymore. So I was a bit confused to find a Samsung family fridge at the truck stop, in the lightning storm, in the Terminator movie, instead of Arnold. But of course I was also quite relieved, because I didn't really want to get terminated. I became even more confused when I noticed that the fridge came from 2016 and the movie came from 1984. I realised that there must be a rupture in the fabric of space-time. This made me think that maybe this fridge could be the boat that I was looking for. So in a kind of dreamlike stupor, I asked it, "What the hell are you doing here?" And surprisingly, it answered me back. It said, "Hello, Sam. I think rather than what the hell, you mean what's the heaven? Well, you see, I come from the future." I'm sorry, it's also got a British accent. Where everything is fine. I was even more surprised by this, because, as you know, I was preparing for the end of the world. So I said, "What do you mean you come from the future where everything is fine?" And it said, "I mean, I am a computer program sent cunningly back through time using various clever physics techniques. Time travel is still a bit complicated, so when we decided we should send a message back in time to let you know that everything is going to be all right, we looked around for the most useless thing that you had, which could accommodate our incredible machine intelligence. We found this Samsung family fridge, the ultimate symbol of selfish consumerism and ridiculous capitalism that the 21st century had offered up at that point." But actually, in the future, most people prefer to hand the cooking over to people who are really passionate about it. Once the forces of positive social change regained control of advertising, news media, and blockbuster movies, they were able to alter the way people thought and behaved. Crazy idea, though. News media, advertising, and blockbusters change the way people think about the world. So, there are people who spend a good part of their time cooking, and the others just come and enjoy their efforts when they want to eat. Most city centres, after they were largely emptied of shops, another outdated idea that was discouraged, are now largely given over to big kitchens and eating halls of different sizes, so people can meet friends or family, join large communal meals, or just mingle with other individuals. It really worked well. And of course, that means supermarkets are also a thing of the past. Food is sourced, mostly locally, by the cooks, and if it needs to come from further away, it is transferred through the Global Stuff Distribution System, or SDS. Oh, phew, that was a lot of information. I'm glad you still have acronyms in the future. Yes, joking. We also joke in the future. But perhaps these red tomatoes and sacrificial animals have some kind of cathartic bloodletting built into them to help people in a contained way. So there are lots of good things about Fiesta. Maybe we need it, and Utopia. So then my thinking is, if we need them both, then perhaps they can be twinned to make a more positive tool together than they can be alone. If you talk about Utopia, starting with Thomas More, the key use of utopic thinking is as a tool to critique the present. You talk about the future and look back and comment on what's wrong with today. That's always the point of it. And as we've said, one pitfall of Fiesta is getting stuck in the past. A counterpositional pitfall of Utopia is getting fixated on a certain specific future, which then requires bloodshed to be reached in urgency. And as we've noted, uncontained bloodshed is bad. But if we combine them, perhaps we can use the combined strands to help Fiesta keep fresh, alive, and future-orientated. To take that a little further, if you think only about the past, you can't get to the future. And as the past gets further away, it has less significance for events in the moving present. If, on the other hand, you position your rituals pointing towards the future, then perhaps they have more chance of staying fresh and renewing themselves as active signifiers for positive change. So the idea, because I talked about kind of moving beyond the fridge to a way of society operating that was different. So the thought is that maybe you could all help to pass me through the fridge towards the future. I know that you're strong, Mario, but
I think we need more people in
there. Something like that.
I
would love to. I'm going!
Okay,
this is working out very nicely.
Yeah.
the present.
Okay, cool.
I like the present.
I'm learning it.
Great, well, thanks. That's the end of my talk.
Applause for them.
Thanks, great.